years old. Third row pew, John 3:16. Something changed in me. Red letters coming off the page, flooding my heart with amazing grace. I knew then, I believe, and those roots run deep. Oh, I've been through some faith-shaking hard times, but nothing's gonna make me forget. Every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I can hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loves me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know His word is true. It all started with a heart stirring, spirit moving Sunday sermon. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Gonna have my worries, well that's part of life. When I think of those stories about what my God can do, He's still moving like He did back then. Born again people, can I get an amen? We've all seen the proof, He makes all things new. Even all those faith-shaking hard times, I never wanna stop remembering. Every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I can hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loves me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know His word is true. It all started with a heart stirring, spirit moving Sunday sermon. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, ain't no doubt. So I'm gonna keep on talking about. Every one of those Sunday sermons, every time that choir would sing, I can hear my Savior calling, telling me how much He loves me. No matter what the world throws at me, I know I'll make it through. All because of those heart-stirring, spirit-moving Sunday sermons. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me. Devil gonna try to take me out of that church, but you can't take the church out of me.
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Woo! Sunday morning. Hallelujah. Man, I've already heard this morning that there's birthdays, so we're going to start with birthdays and anniversaries, and I know there's one over here. Come on! I know you can run on up here. Come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on. All right. And there's another one over there, but I don't think that she's going to run up here. There's one over there. Yeah, tomorrow. She says she's going to come next week. She don't want to come with you today. She don't want to take no... Okay, ready for the happy birthday? All right. Let's everybody stand up and sing happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right. Hallelujah. Yay. Woo. All right. Okay. We're going to go right into praise and worship. How about that? Woo.
I remember when my mother
said, All right, we're going to get it right. Here we go.
I remember when a long-lost sinner met a good, good God. I remember when my heart was broken, but now it's not. I've tasted and I've seen, you've been so good to me. From the moment that you changed my life, God, you never stopped. I'm gonna sing it, I'm gonna shout it, I'm gonna lift my hands in praise. No matter what is gonna come my way, all you've done for me, I give you the glory. From the valley to the victory, I know my God is gonna fight for me. So when the devil comes trying to get me, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil comes trying to get me, gonna praise the Lord. From the moment when the sun starts rising till the sun goes down, I'm surrendering a million mercies. I can feel them now. I've tasted and I've seen, you've been so good to me. Got a melody inside my heart, oh, how sweet, sweet sound. I'm gonna sing it, I'm gonna shout it, I'm gonna lift my hands in praise. No matter what is gonna come my way, all you've done for me, I give you the glory. From the valley to the victory, I know my God is gonna fight for me. So when the devil comes trying to get me, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil comes trying to get me, gonna praise the Lord. In every high, in every low, my hope is found in Christ alone. And here on earth, when I get home, my hope is found in Christ alone.
Sing it. I'm gonna shout it.
Come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna lift my hands in
praise. Come praise the Lord.
Come on.
Come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna sing it.
Come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna shout it.
Come praise the Lord.
I'm gonna lift my hands in
praise.
All you've done for me,
come praise the Lord.
I give you the glory,
come praise the Lord.
From the valley to the victory, I know my God is gonna fight for me. So when the devil comes try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil comes try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. So when the devil comes try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil comes try to get me, gonna praise the Lord.
Amen. Wow. I guess those two songs have really told the devil something. He can just leave. He's not welcome here. Hallelujah. Amen.
Sings, holy.
Thousand generations falling down in worship, sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who's gone before us, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all.
And the angels cry, holy. All creation cries, holy. You are lifted high.
holy, holy forever.
I've been forgiven. Song forever to the Lamb. If you walk in freedom, if you bear His name, sing a song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing a song forever to the Lamb. And the angels cry, oh, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, holy, to the King of Kings. Holy, He will always be. Holy, holy forever. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. Your name stands above them all. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name.
When we figure that out, that He is holy, hallelujah, that we are not holy, amen. And He's coming back very, very soon. Woo. Someone asked for a hymn. Here comes a hymn.
Presence daily.
surrender all. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all.
Playing those old songs, but hallelujah, amen.
You are
out.
Let's give God a good hand clap of praise. Amen. You glad to be here? Say amen. We're going to stand together and pray. I want you to join your hearts with me this morning as we have agreement. We all need, as believers, to be spirit-filled, filled with the Spirit. I want to read something that we talked about a couple weeks on our Wednesday night service about worship. We need to spend a whole week, saturate your whole life, all week in prayer. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, so that when you come to church on Sunday, you anticipate a great worship service. But there's things that we have to do. The church is not like a gas station you stop by occasionally and just get a little fill up. You got to be full every day. And so I pray today in the name of Jesus that every born-again believer today will ask the Lord to fill them with the Holy Spirit so we can have a great worship service. Also, as we come together today, you need to focus on yourself. Get your heart, cultivate your heart. Allow God to speak to your heart today that we can hear from the Lord. The Bible says that we should have, God gives us that spiritual ear so we can hear what God has to say. My prayer today is when you go home today, that you know you have been in a mighty, unusual service. That God has spoken to you in a great way. Now, during worship, you need to be a very attentive. Focus on what's going on, what God's doing. Listen to the Word of God. We also need to be reverent. We need to worship the Lord, respect God. When we're worshiping and singing, praising the Lord, or to get your stinking hands out your stinking pockets. Somebody say amen. We're talking about God. Now, we ain't talking about a president or governor or a preacher or even a prophet. We're talking about God Almighty. We ought to be praising Him and giving Him glory. Now, I pray and hope that no one who comes to church here, when you get to heaven, you have to go to praise and worship school. So you learn how to worship the Lord, because we're going to worship Him when we get there. Would you say amen? We need to be focused today. Don't waste our time. We need to focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. And we need to be obedient to the Spirit of God. The Bible says that we should not quench the Holy Spirit. If God is speaking to you to do something, do it. If God says move, move. Amen. If you're saved today, this altar is for everybody. That we can come now because of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we can come boldly to the throne of grace and mercy, and we can find help in our time of need. I dare say everyone here, probably 90% of us here today, we all have a need that only God can meet. Do I have a witness? God can meet that need. God is available to us today. We are the children of the Most High God. We want to pray together today. We want to remember our sheriff's family as they have their service today in Florence. Remember his family. That God would be with them and comfort them in his passing. Also, we have quite a few of our members in the law enforcement that they're there today to help take care of the service. Pray God would be with them. Also, Brother Tony's having a procedure tomorrow. Want to pray for him. Kirk Hamilton's getting better. He had one more stint Wednesday, and he's doing a whole lot better since he's had those three stints put in. Remember Miss Judy Foley. That God will continue with Miss Judy. If Miss Judy was not sick, she'd be in church. But we need to pray for her, that God will take care of her. If you have a need, would you lift your hand to the Lord? Lift your hand, knowing that God can take care of that need. We didn't come just to show up, but we come to receive from the Lord today. Let me tell you how to receive from God. We need more God in our life. And the other way we're going to have more God in our life is going to have to be more of us. We've got to give more of ourselves to God so He can fill us up with His Spirit. Let's pray together. Father, we pray right now in agreement, Lord Jesus, that God, you would fill your house with God, the Holy Spirit. Lord, there's nothing we can do, God, without your help. And God, you send us the helper, the Holy Ghost. And I pray, God, you would fill every born-again believer here today, Lord. And God, that may we will walk in the Spirit, be what you have saved us to be, dear God. And I pray, Lord, you would move in a mighty way, Lord Jesus. God, you speak to us. Give us that ear that we can hear what we need to hear. God, you know us better than we know ourselves. And I want to thank you, dear Lord God, that we have full confidence that you're able to do exceedingly and abundantly, far and high above what we can ever imagine or even think. God, you can do it because you're God. You're omnipotent, all-powerful God. There's no one anywhere, anyhow, to be able to be compared to you, Lord. And we thank you, dear Lord God, today for your faithfulness. God, you're always faithful. God, you're never late. You're always on time. And we thank you, dear Lord God, today. We stand on the Lord Jesus, the Word of God, on a sure foundation. We pray, dear God, for our land. Our nation is sick. I'm talking about absolute sickness in our land, God, today. What we're seeing and hearing, and God, things that are going on, everything they say is bad is good, and everything they say is good is bad. Everything's against your holy word, God. Lord God, have mercy on us, God. Help and heal our land. And God, we know, Lord, healing comes through the prayers of your people. And we pray, dear Lord God, today that you'd move in a mighty way. Move in our hearts, in this sanctuary, across our land. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church said amen. If you love God, give him a great big hand clap of praise. Amen. You may be seated.
In Psalm 34, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. And magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. They looked to him and were radiant, and their faces were not ashamed. This poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him, and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers them. Just like when Jacob was encamped, he had sent everybody on ahead. His brother Esau was chasing him, and he was trying to get his family into safety. And Genesis 32:14 tells us, and Jacob was all alone, all by himself, without anything. Sometimes God will leave you all alone, without anything. But a man came and wrestled with him, put his hip out of joint. That's a lot of pain. Put him into pain. And Jacob said, I'm not going to let you go till you bless me. If you got a hip out of joint and you're in pain, hold on to Jesus, because it said the Lord God left him. Jesus came to him. God left him to teach him something. And Jesus came and wrestled with him. And it was painful. And it hurt. And he limped for the rest of his life. Now, you might have had something happen to you, and you've limped the rest of your life as a result of it. But look at the blessing God gave you from it. Look what came out of it. So hold on to him. Don't let him go till he blesses you. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Amen.
Let's give the Lord a good hand clap, will you? Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's all stand together. Let's all stand together. Praise the Lord. I was speaking Wednesday night. All y'all who don't realize we have church. on Wednesday night. And I pray that God will soon get your attention, that we need Bible study teaching of God's Word. But we talked about money and the purpose of it. The purpose of money is for us to recognize the Lord. That everything that we have, we need to realize it came from God. Now, God is a giver, but He also can take it. But we need to realize that who we are and what God has done for us, we're blessed. And we need to praise the Lord and bless Him. If God's been good to you, would you say amen? Amen. Thank you so much for being faithful in your giving. We thank God that we have this opportunity when we come to the house of the Lord to worship the Lord in giving. Every one of us are important. And what God has given you to return back to Him is very important. And so we all work together to worship the Lord together. God will continue to bless us. Will you say amen? Let's pray and ask God to bless our time of giving.
Father, help us this day. We just come to you and ask you to go ahead of us and take care of all of our needs according to your riches and glory. We ask a special blessing, Father, on every home and life that's represented in here, their extended families, Lord. Wherever they're seeking you, I pray that they may find you, O Lord, that salvation would come to the lost, and that, Lord, you would bless each family. In Jesus' name, amen.
Before you come this morning, Brother Frank, raise your hand over there. Helping and his wife are helping with our, and his daughter are helping with our children. And if you want to assist them, make yourself available. Make sure you contact them the day before you leave. Yes, occasionally you get opportunity to work with the children. And we thank God for our children. And it's so important that we have children in the church. But contact him. Let him know that you will help him every other Sunday or whenever they have the puppet ministry. They're going to be doing some crafts. And I think today they're going to be having hot dogs and a good time. But then they share the gospel. So make yourself available. Let him know before you leave today that you'll be willing to help him one Sunday. Amen. Let's worship the Lord in giving. All the children, ladies and gentlemen, come quickly as we worship the Lord in giving. Come quickly. Now, children, to go next door.
Amen. I'll tell you, the Lord, I'm not going to say bless me, but I know he's put this in my life for a reason. But this is tough. This Alzheimer's stuff is tough. And I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of times I spend down in the valley. But even though I'm in the valley, there's times when he lifts me up on that mountain just to see. And, man, I'm going to tell you, it's all worth it. He's there in both places. He's there when I'm in the valley going through. But he's also standing there when there's a victory. Go ahead. Down his son. to suffer rejection and pay for the crimes he had not done. For what earthly reason would the Father let him hang on a tree? I wept with the answer, the one earthly reason was me.
Ooh.
Let's all stand together. Come on now. Let's all give God a great big hand clap. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I'll tell you, I think Barabbas wrote that song. Amen. We all guilty. We all should have been crucified, killed, lost our lives for our sins. And he who was tempted but never sinned willingly gave his life. I tell you, if that song don't touch you, I don't know if you know the Lord or not. What a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful word. Amen. We're going to look together today in chapter 4 in 1 John. And we thank the Lord for his word as we move through it expositorily, just looking from verse to verse. When we get to it, we deal with it. John, under the inspiration of God, the Holy Spirit. God, the Holy Spirit. Anybody that's ever been used by God has been directed by the Spirit of God. Those disciples were never the same after Pentecost. And we, after salvation, we should never be the same again. Will you say amen? And what we need today in the church today is God, the Holy Spirit, in our lives, and when we come together, filling up the sanctuary. Now, we're going to look together today. We need to understand the great need today of the church is a spiritual walk. Now, what we don't need in the church today is more money or more members or a new message. What we need is the Holy Spirit. More of God, the Holy Spirit in your life and my life. So that when we come together, we have more of God. I pray today, I pray that you would pray all week and agree together. Then we come together, God would meet us here. The only way we're going to meet with God is by the power of the Holy Spirit. And every day we got to walk with God is by the power of the Holy Spirit. Not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Last week we talked about the things and the people, the world which we live in, how they so hate God. They're against God. They use God's name so loosely. They don't reverence God. They put God down. They curse in the name of our God. And God, we see in the Word of God that John had inspired him. He gave us a serious warning about a wicked spirit and worldly wisdom. The Bible tells us that though that we are in the world, that we don't have the mind of the world. We don't live according to this world. We're just passing through. Would you say amen? Now, we look together in 1 John 4, beginning in verse 7. John writes, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God." As I read that this morning, what a truth there. Everybody that loveth is of God and knows God. It's one thing to say, "Well, I love the Lord," but do you know who you love? Do you know who you love? This Bible today, that this no-count preacher is trying to preach today, is God's love letter to his people. And the only way you're going to know God is by knowing this book, this letter. And then we don't see the need of the Word of God. We need God's Word in our life. So we cannot just say that we love God, but we need to know Him. By the way, how can you say you love somebody you don't even know? We got to know Him. The Bible said in verse 8, "He that loveth not God, he that loveth not God, knoweth not God, knoweth God, for God is love. And this is manifested or revealed that love is God of God toward us, because that God sent His only begotten Son in the world that we might live through Him. Herein is love, that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins." That word means the atonement. "Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwells in us, and His love is perfected and made complete in us. Hereby know that we dwell in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. We have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in the world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has torment. He that fears is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, and hate his brother, he's a liar. For he has loved not his brother whom he has seen. How can he say he loves God who he hasn't seen? And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God loves his brother also. You may be seated. May God bless his holy word. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. And we ask, dear Lord God, that you would allow your Holy Spirit, God, to fill our hearts today. God, help us, Lord Jesus, to have clear hearing from the word of God, because faith comes by hearing and hearing God's word. Father, help us to hear the message. God, help us to know the truth, dear Lord God. And we pray, Lord Jesus, the preacher, the Holy Spirit, will preach here, Lord God, today and manifest his presence, saving lost souls and stirring the saints of God for your glory. Lord, we love you and we praise you and we thank you because you are God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now we see John has shifted his thoughts here. He gives us the answer that always defeats wickedness and worldliness. And the answer is love. That we love God because he loves us. John said we need a spiritual walk. And the true evidence that we're truly been born again in the Holy of the Holy Spirit is that we are supernaturally possessed the God-given ability to love God and to love one another. I have been in ministry. I have been in churches with people who will outwardly and unashamedly declare people that they don't like or they don't love. Let me tell you something. These people, according to the word of God, does not have the love of God in them and don't know God. If you know God and know that God loves you and God saved you in spite of you, you have no choice but freely and willingly to love everybody. It don't matter who comes in these doors. It don't matter the color of skin. It don't matter what kind of clothes they got on. It don't matter what they smell like. It don't matter if they was in jail last night and going to jail today. We got to love everybody. Somebody ought to shout and say amen. Many among us believe the evidence that we are walking in the Spirit is that we're speaking in tongues or shouting in the church and able to quote Bible verses and walk in a higher level than other people. Not so. That ain't what the Bible says. Evidence that you have been saved is that you love people. That you love everybody. If you have a problem with somebody, you ask God, help me, Lord, to love that person I have a problem with. So the real test, John states, is found in these few verses from the very lips of God. The very Spirit of God speaks to us. He spoke through John. And he said, first of all, in verse 7 and 8, love one another, loving one another proves that we are born of God and that we know him. Again now, if you can't love people, you're not born of God and you don't know God. That's what the Bible says. Not that the effort you go to, that you love God because you come to church. That's a good indication. But God says that you are born again and you know God because you love everybody. We got to love people. This speaks of the new birth and the love that follows. It's the fruit of the Spirit of God, love. People should see that we're born of God and possess the nature of God by how we love people. By how we love people. Are you able to love people? Do you even care for people? Do you even care if people die and go to heaven or people die and go to hell? We got to love everybody. The true evidence that we've been born again is we've able to see people like the Lord Jesus sees people. He sees people through the love of God because He is God. Jesus was willing to die for all people. Do you notice that most of the people He spent time with were demon-possessed, or they were about to die, or they were the outcast, or they were people nobody else wanted to be around. It reminds me of being in Romania and sharing the gospel when the Romanian people would say something like this: well, don't go hanging around the gypsy people, because they thought they were better than the gypsies. And we saw more gypsies saved than we seen actually Romanian people saved. I tell you, you're not the one who decides the love of God. You got to love everybody. We ought to be willing to care for people. If we do care, the power, listen, this proves that we're not one born of God, but we know God. We're walking in the Spirit if we're telling people about the love of God. John says in verse 8 very clearly, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. You say you know Him. Do you love people? If we don't love and care for people, we can't say we're born again and know God. The things that should motivate us to witness of God's great love is that God loved us. The Bible says that God has commended His love toward us while that we were nothing but low-down sinners. That God loves us. He demonstrated it. Ephesians 2:7 says, God showed His exceeding abundant riches of His grace and His kindness toward us through the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, how do we know God? It's only through the Lord Jesus. How did God demonstrate His love? It's by the love of the Lord Jesus. Loving one another proves that we see God's love. You know, I often say that people don't witness and tell people about the Lord Jesus because they don't know Him. How can we say that we know God? How can we say that we filled with the Holy Spirit of God? The fruits of the Spirit of God, the first fruit is love. You've got to have love first. Now, the reason why we don't tell people, maybe it's because you're not saved, or that you realize that God loved you while you were a sinner. While we were against God, we were at an enemy against God, and He loved us. Your love is something that will be seen, not just spoken. Love is an action word. You're saying something's cheap. We got to show it. Verse 9, John said, we got to see God's love before we can show and share God's love. How can I see God's love? Very clearly, very simply. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. God has already demonstrated His love. And verse 9 says that we might live through Him. You can't have life apart from the Lord Jesus. You can try everything you want to try. You can join every secular organization and die and go to hell. The only way we can ever get into heaven is by the Lord Jesus. We got to have the eye of faith. We must see by faith the Lord Jesus on the cross of Calvary. And we live by faith because we believe in the Lord Jesus. Amen. That we may live through Him. Now listen, church, no man can see God unless they first see Calvary. How do we get to God? What is the avenue? What is the bridge to God? It's the Lord Jesus. People say, well, I know God. They don't know Jesus. They don't possess the Spirit of God. How can they say they know God? Come on now. We've got to understand here. It's through the eyes of Calvary where the love of God was manifested in the actions of the Lord Jesus. What Jesus did proved the love of God. Verse 10 tells us here is love. Not that we love God, but that He loved us. And He sent His Son to be the atonement for our sins. God required a perfect sacrifice. The only perfect sacrifice is the Lord Jesus. The process of love is God so loved us, not that we loved Him. God proved His love. Note, He sent His Son to be the atonement for our sin. Jesus paid for our sin. Somebody say amen. The Bible says in Romans 3:23 that we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the Bible says in verse 24, very clearly, being justified without cause freely by His grace through the redemption that's in the Lord Jesus Christ, whom God sent forth to be our mercy seat through faith in His blood to declare His righteousness for the remission, the passing over of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of him which believes in the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is the just redeemer, and He also is our justifier. So through the eyes of faith, we see Jesus on the cross of Calvary. The blood of Jesus washed away our sins. And we know that we are sinners, and we look to Him, and we receive His grace, His redemption, and His mercy, and we trust Him. And God sees us as justified, made right, righteous in the Lord Jesus. In verse 11, the Bible says, beloved, if God so loved us, we're to love one another. It's amazing, you hear so often of churches in turmoil. One church member against the other church member, trying to cause chaos and cause trouble in the house of God. I tell you, friend, you better be careful when you mess with God or even the family of God. Listen, we got to understand it cannot be any plainer than this, that we love God because He first loved us. Also, loving one another proves that God's Spirit lives inside of us. There's no other way that a man or a woman could live in a right way apart from the Holy Spirit living inside of us. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. If y'all listen to me, say amen. God lives inside of us. There's nothing we can do to please God. We can't get to God. We can't hear from God. We cannot have fellowship with God the Father or the Son apart from God the Holy Spirit. Listen very carefully in verse 12. No man seeing God at any time. If we love one another, God dwells in us. His love is complete in us. Hereby know that we dwell in Him and He in us, because He has given us of His Spirit. This speaks of the indwelling of God the Holy Spirit. We are that temple. Amen. John declared a great truth here. No man has seen God at any time. All these people say they've been to heaven and come back. All they want to do is sell a book. Want to go out and win people to Jesus. Want to go to the hospital and lay hands on the sick and the dead and raise them up. The Bible said ain't nobody seen God at any time. Now, God is not known by sight. No man has seen Him, God, face to face. The Bible said that Moses seen His backside, but no man has seen the face of God. Then Jesus said in John 1:18, no man has seen God at any time. And then the only begotten Son, which is in the bosom, the heart of the Father, He has declared Him. So anyway, if you ever want to see God, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no man can come to the Father or see the Father except by me. He's the only way. John 14:8, Philip said, Lord, show us the Father. And Jesus said, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me? He that has seen me has seen the Father. Now John is saying, if we have seen God by faith, we will reveal God in us by the Holy Spirit, by how we love one another. How that we love one another. And His love will be perfected and complete in us. And salvation, think about it, it's a process. You're saved by the grace of God. God is working every day in your life, saving you. You are saved. God is perfecting you. He's changing you. Amen. One glad day we're going to be completely in the presence of God. The Bible teaches that we have salvation. When you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, you shall be saved. No matter who you are, God, a Savior. God's the author and the finisher of your faith. If He didn't save you, He's not responsible to complete you. But if you're saved today, you know you're saved. You have salvation. And then here is what's lacking in the life of many believers is transformation. God changes you. You don't want to go where you used to go. You don't want to have the same habits that you used to have before you got saved. You have a deep hunger for the Word of God. You come to the house of God where you know you're going to get the Word of God. Somebody say amen. So you're saved. Transformation. And one glad morning is glorification. We're going to see the Lord, and behold, we're going to be just like Him. And the Bible said the Spirit of God, Romans 8:16, will bear witness with your spirit that you know you're a child of God. John is saying people should recognize that the Holy Ghost dwells in us because we live and walk in the Spirit. That means we're controlled by the mind of God, by God Himself. Jesus said in John's Gospel, in John chapter 14, very clearly, look what He said He's done for us. In the Scripture, John declares in John chapter 14, verse 16, I will pray the Father, and He will give you another Comforter. Now, friend, we know what that is saying right there is, when Jesus was with those disciples, they had peace and comfort. Now, Jesus said, I'm going to do what the Father has asked me to do, but I'm going to send you somebody else to give you comfort, that He may abide with you, listen now, forever. Forever. That word abide means stay, pretty simply. I'm going to stay with you forever. Forever. Even the Spirit of truth in the world cannot receive because it seeth Him not, neither knoweth Him, appreciates Him, but you know Him, for He dwells with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I'm going to come to you. Yet a little while, and the world sees me no more, but you see me because I live, you shall live also. Why do we live forever? We live forever and ever and ever. My children, I was speaking to them yesterday. They're talking about getting old, and one day you're going to die. I said, I'm not going to die. I'm going to live forever. I already died. I died in Christ. I tell you, when you come to my funeral, I tell you, I'm more alive then than I ever can be. Because I'm going to be alive in the Lord. Yet that day you shall know that I'm in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. We're going to be together. Together with the Lord Jesus. Listen, loving one another proves that our testimony and confessions are true. Now listen very carefully. A lot of people say a lot of things that's a lie. But when you love somebody, that's a good testimony that when you said you got saved, it really happened. Look what he says in verse 14. We have seen and do testify the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. Whosoever should confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him and he in God. Isn't that something? And we have known and believed the love that God has to us. God is love, and he that dwells in the love dwelleth in God and God in him. You know, we should be a people that love people. Not judging people, but love people. Now, these verses, John gives his testimony that he and the early believers had seen and do testify that the Father sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. The Bible said in John 1:1, the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. Same was in the beginning with him. The Word of God has always been. Think about it. This great promise is to the whole world. It's the Word of God. Jesus is the living Word. How in the day can people see God and believe in God and accept God by faith? Because the Word of God is the living Word. And the Bible said in Romans 10:13, listen now, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's the Word of God. That's the proof. That's the evidence. John said, we have seen, testified, the Father sent the Son to save the world. Verse 15 states, whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwells in him and him in God. Now this speaks here of salvation, but also speaks of confession. And it speaks of godly fellowship. The Bible said in Romans 10:9-10, if thou shalt confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believes into righteousness, with his mouth confession is made unto salvation. We have a lot of these people who say they saved. They say they're going to heaven. They may even want to be baptized, but they're ashamed to make a public confession. If you're ashamed of him now, he'll be ashamed of you then. The Bible said, whosoever believes in the Lord Jesus in Romans 10:11 will not be ashamed. If you really want to be a part of God's family, you will make a public confession of your faith. That you had the real possession of your faith, the Lord Jesus Christ. But think about it. There must first be conviction. We are convicted by the preacher, the Holy Spirit. The Word of God convicts us. After conviction, then comes a confession. So many people, they have a worldly conviction. They get a little upset and cry a little bit and a little emotional because they're in the presence of God, but they don't have a real confession. And the life proves the facts. It also speaks of communication. He's in us, and we in him. We have a real relationship. A real relationship with God. Now the truth is, Jesus is God. He's Lord. He's Savior. He's our soon coming King. Jehovah's Witness says Jesus is not God. Mormonism says Jesus is not God. Mr. Brown, the author of Modern Day Greatest Lies, says Jesus is not God in the Da Vinci Code. He is God. When you've seen the Son, you've seen the Father. The Bible, God's holy word, inspired word, says one day every knee shall bow. All these people who said that Jesus was not God, one day every knee shall bow, every tongue will confess to the glory of God the Father that Jesus is Lord. Everybody to the glory of God the Father. It will be a universal confession. Verse 16 says, and we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwells in God and God in him. You cannot say that you're better than somebody else. You cannot say the white race is better than the black race. You can't say the black race is better than the white race or the brown race or the yellow or the red. There's two kind of races on the planet today. There's a saved race and a lost race. You are either in one and you are either on the other. And if you are saved by the grace of God and you love God, you're going to love everybody. You're going to love everybody. We've been here almost 21 years. It has not been easy, but we're going to love everybody. We've loved everybody, and we're going to keep on loving everybody. We've loved some of those people who have done nothing but cause trouble and heartache in this church. And when I see them, I said, dear God, help me not to be in the flesh, but be in the spirit. And speak and keep walking. Come on now, you got to love people. Note here what they knew and believed. That God is love. Listen now, in Christ he proved it. He demonstrated it on the cross of Calvary, the death, burial, and the resurrection. The true born again believer must love one another, love lost people. Our love for one another is the way we can tell that you're saved. It's a supernatural working of God. God will change you. The sad truth of the matter is that when we're young and people growing up in houses of unsaved people, they begin to teach you things that are contrary to the Word of God. You can't love them people. They're a different color than you are. They're trying to harm you. They're trying to hurt you. You better get out of that and get in the Word of God. Get the Spirit of God in you and love everybody. Love everybody. Love everybody. Love them. You may not like them, but you got to love them. Loving one another proves that God is going to deliver us from the coming judgment. Look in verse 17. You still with me? Say amen. Here is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. Now notice very carefully, John makes a bold declaration of the soon coming judgment. There are going to be two judgments, one for the believer, the bema seat of Christ. We're going to be judged by what we've done in our new life. What have we done with Christ? Have we loved Him? Have we sacrificed for Him? Have we sought Him? Have we shared Him? Do we look for Him? Do we really love Him? There will also be the unbelievers, the great white throne judgment. All those people who reject the Lord Jesus will be judged at the great white throne. Jesus Christ, listen now, He's the judge and the justifier. And all will be judged by and according to the Word of God. So we ought to know what the Word of God says. I tell you, if you want to know something, you ought to read the Word of God. Now let me go ahead and embarrass myself and some of you men today. How many of you have gotten a grill and you didn't even read the instructions? And you began to put it together and it looked like something from outer space. It would not work. You couldn't roll it. It would not fire. You know why? It would not stand because you forgot to read the instructions. How are we going to get to heaven? How are we going to be able to stand in peace and boldness before God Almighty if we have not adhered to God's holy instructions, the commandments, and the Word of God? The Bible tells us there's going to be a great separation. Notice very carefully in Matthew 12:36. But I say to you that every idle word that man shall speak, they shall give account thereof on the day of judgment. Oh, Lordy. Everything you've ever said, every idle word that you've ever spoken, God's going to judge us. Amen. By the Word of God, what we've done. The Bible said in Matthew 25, verse 31, when the Son of Man shall come in His glory, all the holy angels with Him, then shall He sit upon the throne of His glory. And before Him shall be gathered all nations, and He shall separate them one from another, as the shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And He shall set the sheep on His right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on the right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, and inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. God has prepared a place for us. Would you say amen? Come on now. I was telling one of my children yesterday, if y'all had children younger and you grew up and you had children, I said, you know what? I can't have a stinking thing. Everything I got, you can't find it. I said, thank God for heaven, Lucille. I got a home in glory and can't nobody take it. And can't nobody lose it. I can't find a pliers. I can't find a screwdriver. I can't find nothing. One time I had it, but it's gone. That ain't the way God works. God has prepared a place for us in glory, and ain't nobody going to take it, and it can't be lost. Somebody ought to say amen. There's going to be a great separation. God is going to separate the goat from the sheep. Colossians 3:24. The Bible says, knowing that of the Lord you shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. But he that doeth wrong shall receive the wrong which he had done, and there is no respect of persons. Lord have mercy. Don't you wish our government would operate that way? That's all I got to say about that. It don't matter what your last name is. God says, or your first name, or the color of your skin, or what nation that you live in, at that day of judgment, nobody gets respect. Nobody's going to be looked up higher than the other person. Nobody's going to be treated better than the other person. If you're saved, enter in, thy good and faithful servant. If you're not saved, depart from me, you wicked. I've never known you. And we'll be cast in eternal fire and eternal damnation. The Bible says in verse 24, it says, for you serve the Lord. Who do you serve? We got to serve Him. John states you can be delivered from judgment. Now, how can that be? How can we be delivered from judgment? By living a life of love. And by loving one another perfectly, no hooks. No hooks. Some folks, people call on the church phone all the time. Preacher, we need some food. I said, if you come to church on Sunday, we'll send you home with some food. Come on. Well, you know what? You never see them, they'll hear from them. And they thank you. Didn't they talk bad about you in the community? That church wouldn't even give me no food. Well, I'd rather you go to heaven, amen, by the word of God than die and go to hell with a full belly. Come on now. You got to love people. John states that we got to live a life of love and boldness and that day of judgment because we love people. John said, as Jesus was in the world, we also are to be like him. Not a judger, but a lover of men. No, that the next time he comes now, the next time he comes, it will be judgment. Now listen very carefully, listen quickly. Loving one another proves that God delivers us from fear. And I wrote down there, where was this verse in 2020? Where was this verse in 2020? Dear God. And the truth of the matter is, it wasn't the fact that we all hibernated to our safe havens. But here was the problem. The same people that hibernated during the virus in their homes and couldn't get to church on Sunday was at Walmart all week. Now, if I'm lying, I'm dying. Come on now. All over the world, everywhere, you know what I'm saying, doing all these things but couldn't get to church. The Bible says very carefully here in verse 18, there's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear because fear has torment and punishment. He that fears is not made perfect in love. Now first, fear is not of God, it's of Satan. God gives us, the Bible tells us, a spirit of love and a power and a sound mind. Fear is, I don't know. I hope so. Faith is, I do know, amen, I trust God. See the difference? Our faith comes from the love of God and hearing the word of God, his love letter, the Bible. And John said, there's no fear in love. This means if we really love someone or people, there's no need to fear them because our lives and what and how we treat people in this, and God handles everything for us, and we can depend on God and trust God that he's going to take care of it, that casts out fear. Lord, I've done all that I can do, we say. Now I'm getting out of the way, God, and Lord, you work it all out. Let God take care of it. That's perfected and complete the work of love. Paul states he knew perfect love. And the Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews, and listen to this scripture that nobody likes. Listen what it says in Hebrews 10:22. It said, let us draw near with a true heart of full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our body washed from pure water. That's the word. The word of God will wash you. Now, if you don't believe it, quit coming to church and watch how easy you get filthy and dirty. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and the good works. And here's the word, the scripture nobody likes, verse 25. Not forsaking, neglecting the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting, that word means encouraging one another, and so much the more as you see that day approaching. I'd be a sorry preacher if I wouldn't encourage you and let you know how important it is to come to church. We need the word of God. Like I said this morning, we don't need more members. We don't need more money. What we need is more God. We don't need a new message. This one works. This one works. Listen very carefully. Loving one another proves that we love God. This is the last scripture. We love him, verse 19, because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, who that hasn't seen, how can you say that you love man, you don't love man now that you do see? We've got to love everybody. And this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God loves his brother also. Now, you know, we're brothers and sisters in the Lord. Now notice here, we know that we love God because we know God first loved us. You know, saying you love God, other words, saying you love God actually reflects to the same thing as saying, I love everybody. God loves everybody. He loved the world, didn't he? He didn't just die for South America. He died for the whole world. So actually, when you say you love God, by the power of the Holy Spirit in you and the learning and transformation of your mind and your thinking, you love God because he loves you. There's no way in the world that we can love God until he first made the move to love us. God loves us. God loves us because we have seen, listen, through the eyes of faith, his great love for us. In the Calvary, God so loved the world. He loves us. He proved it, that he gave his only begotten Son, the Lord Jesus, that whosoever will believe in him not perish. He demonstrated his love. From Genesis to Revelation, God's great love is offered, is seen, demonstrated, clearly manifested to us today. Very quickly, we know we love God because we love our brethren. How can we say we love God who we haven't seen if we can't love our brethren that we do see? God gives us an easy example here. We are people of sight. We see people. God says the people that we're able to see, we must love them. There you are. If you can't love people, you better get right with God. Get in your prayer closet. God, help me to love that person. Some people are hard to love, but you got to ask God to help you love them. Now, God says, if you tell me you love me, you don't love somebody else, you're a liar. What a statement that God would say you're a liar. This world here, the wisdom and the atmosphere and the working of the world, the devil is in charge of it. It gets in the minds of people and races of people, and they feuding and fighting against one another all over the world. Don't you get up in that. You got to love everybody. You've got to love everybody. We know we love God because the Bible says we keep his word, the word of God. John said in John 13, 34, 35, a new commandment that I give to you, that you love one another. This is the 13th commandment. As I've loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you have love one for another. You've got to love everybody. Love everybody. I want to quote the scripture again. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him wouldn't perish but have everlasting life. And Jesus said, I came in the world not to condemn the world, but that the world by me might be saved. This is the spiritual walk, that we love people. Love one another. Think of the impact you can make at work tomorrow. Think of the impact you can make in your family, in your community, if you just love people. And I'm going to tell you something. People are people, and people will hurt you, and people will spitefully come against you. They'll try to take you out. They'll do some of the awful things you could ever imagine, but you've got to love them. You've got to love them. Don't show them what they show you. Jesus said, if they strike you on one side, turn the other cheek and let them strike the other side. Just let them go ahead and do and pray, God, you bless them according to the works. Let God take care of it. And here, I believe, is probably one of the most powerful scriptures in all the Bible. Greater love has no man than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friends. You know, people would say, preacher, ain't you about sick and tired of texting people, calling people, getting to church and going by the house, blowing the horn, hollering at them, contacting them? No, I don't get tired of it because I love people. I love every one of you. I like to see you move and how you move about. Everybody in here is different. Everybody has a different walk about them. Amen? They have a different, you know, things about them. I like to see them walking into church with the children, the family, anxious to get to church and sit where they like to sit. I love people. It don't matter how long they have been out. I'm still want to try to get in touch with them. It don't matter, listen to me very carefully, how much trouble they are. You still love them. Amen. Some of those sheep are about you. Some of them have a little bit of mange. Some of them's mean. Some of them's real loving. But a real shepherd loves the sheep. And he lets God do the separating. Would you say amen? I appreciate all of you. I love all of you. Because God loved me. Stay on your feet, would you please? Would you agree with me today that we are not leave this church today until we ask the Spirit of God to fill us? You know, we are earthen vessels. You say, well, preacher, you don't know about me and the things about me. And, you know, as I get to know you, I find out a lot of things about you that kind of reminds me of me. But here's the thing that we need to take to heart. You know, the Bible said we are earthen vessel. You know what? In those vessels that we are, there's cracks and scars and all kind of things we've done and things we regret that we've done in our life. Anybody regret something you've done in your life? I mean, there's nobody in this building perfect but the Holy Spirit of God. But you know, everywhere there's a crack in that jar that we are, God compares us to. Let me tell you something. You know what? That's where the light comes out. Where you messed up. The trouble you were. The things you done. The wrong. Let that trouble be your sounding board. That why I was a sinner. Gosh. I don't know what you're going to sing, Billy, but I swear, please. Sing that song again, will you please? Can you have them put it up? For what earthly reason? I tell you, man, that thing knocks the plumb breath out of me. When I think about how evil I could be and how good God is. For what earthly reason did Jesus die? For me, for you. If that don't get us to move, to shine, reflect the love of God, I don't know what will. Have you listened to the words of this song? I'm going to ask you this morning, maybe, I hope I'm not asking too much, and it don't hurt you to move, but will you join me the day as we have this song? First of all, if you're not saved, meet me here. I'll tell you how to meet the Savior. But church, today, will you please, as I plead to you, will you please, during this song of invitation, find you a place in this altar and say, Lord, fill me. Cleanse me, Lord God, of anything that would hinder my life from being filled. We have to be filled, but we have no room. Some things God needs to take from us before God can give to us. As we have this song of invitation, Mary Beth, come here, baby. Stand with me. It's not easy, but it's good. You come as the Lord leads you. Lord, cleanse me. Lord, fill me with your Holy Spirit.
Rejection and pay for the crimes.
with the Father, let him hang on a tree. I wept with the answer that one earthly reason was me.
Have you forgot? Give the Lord a hand clap of praise, will you? Amen. Please beseech you, I ask you earnestly, if you will commit with me every day, Lord, fill me, with your Holy Spirit. Help me, Lord. And you pray with me, Lord. Meet us on Sunday, Lord. We come to worship together, Lord. We want you to fill this place with your presence. Would you say amen? Just continue to seek the Lord and praise him. Please do all you can to get your family, friends, and workmates and acquaintances to the house of God. It's been good today. Don't forget about what God's done for you. Amen. Father, we love you. We thank you for this day. And because you love us, God, I thank you for this church family, for what you're doing. God, I'm thankful, God, that you're building a mighty work, a mighty church, a mighty ministry, dear God, here in this land. And I want to thank you, dear Lord God, that you said you were going to open a door and no man was going to close it. And you were going to do it with us who has no strength. Lord, it's not us, but you, Lord, that we look to build on this foundation that you've laid. We bless you and we praise you. I pray a blessing on everyone here, every individual, and every family. Bless them, dear Lord God, today, as only you can. We bless you and we give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great day. Hope to see you on Wednesday and next Sunday. God bless you.